I'm the moderator for today, so I'm like the host for this talk show. I'm gonna be right here, and I'll be just throwing out questions to our panel. Anytime if you have anything to add on, you can always just raise up your hand and we can pass the mic around. Okay, I'm gonna start right now. Okay, anyway, just check. RPP is ready, right? Okay. Okay, first question. We're gonna ask more about ciphers. As you know, the focus of Pop in Progress 2016, from the first chapter, second chapter, to today, the grand finals, we are focusing on Cypher and the culture of Cypher. So let me throw this question out today is, what is the function of the Cypher and how and why is it important? So maybe let's start with Franny! Woo!
Check. God, is that you? Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. Which one is it? I can't remember.
Afternoon.
Anyhow, Cypher, the importance of its function, right? That's the question.
Yeah, what's the function of a cypher? Why and how is it important?
Well, there's a whole history about it, you know, but being that my generation started in the 90s, the importance of the cipher to me was the exchange of information, the vocabulary, what you had to say. Now, if you had a crew, definitely a cipher of an exchange was eventually going to lead to a battle, because one person to the next was going to take something, get either upset about it and just kind of like, yo, let's just represent for our squad. Let's test our skills, you know? So, check. The cipher would be a way to exchange that. Like, my crew versus your crew. Let's see how well we can do versus you. Or it's just representing styles. Like, if we did nothing but footwork for, let's say, b-boys and poppers, even if poppers were able to break, they would basically be breaking. They wouldn't have to be just poppers, you know what I'm saying? So it would be a test of footwork. The other would be a top rock. So in reality, like, it's also bringing the vibe of building yourself, you know, being able to express what you're going through in a circle. Like, I still cipher to this day. It's 25 years of popping, and I'm now 34 years old. I still go to clubs and create ciphers myself so that I can always help the next person grow as a dancer, as a performer. And it doesn't matter what style, you know, it could be an open cipher for all styles. Just all about that expression of, like, don't be afraid to be yourself. You know what I'm saying? Like, literally, you're jumping in a circle. Just do you. If you're barely beginning, just do you. Be comfortable with who you are. You don't have to impress me. I'm not here to be like judging you every time. You know, I'm just here to exchange and have fun and enjoy like what we love, this dance, the music, all that. So I know I can touch on a little bit more, but yeah, that's kind of like, in a nutshell, my answer, my response.
Hello, I'm back. Okay, maybe I also pose this same question to Prince Jack on my side, because he also joined the Chapter 2 open category. And then I just also want to understand, what do you think cypher culture is in Singapore? Or how do you think it is like at the moment?
Hi, good afternoon. I guess when I started, it was like 2003. When we started popping in Singapore. 2000? So during that time, there was really no information, there was no internet. The only stuff that we could get was off SoSig, and like LimeWire, I think. So we would watch videos of, I think most of the time they were all mostly all American videos, I think. and then we will watch, oh, they're getting down Cypher. So I think for us, when we started, there was only a few of us. So we were dancing with B-boys. Let's say B-boys more. And slowly there was more poppers, and we cyphered, and we basically were just having fun, just exchanging. So there wasn't any crew or, so it's just individual. One of us, then we share information, we might share videos. Oh, you know, we downloaded this, let's exchange, and then we pass it around. And I think this is how it all started in Singapore.
Cool. Yes, of course.
So for me, like dancing in the club for me was actually a way of being antisocial. I would actually create a box around myself. So I was actually an introverted dancer. So a cypher to me is like, it's when popping becomes a social dance. So it's when you share ideas with other people. For a while, and even now to this day, I struggle with entering the cypher, as Frantick knows. he would call me a side buster, because I would be on the side, I'd be feeling the music, but I would be in my own bubble. And then the cypher would slowly drift towards me, and other people would gravitate towards me, and then I would sneak back out the cypher again, go dance in the corner by myself. So it's, it's learning to communicate through your dance. And also, I've noticed through my travels through Asia and stuff, a lot of people, they don't know how to communicate. They don't know how to connect with other dancers. So like they dance within themselves. You can tell they look down, you know? And like, as soon as you start to engage with somebody, when you talk to somebody, you don't go like this. You don't look down at the ground, right? You look, you connect with people. And so that's kind of what a cypher is to me.
All right.
Okay, maybe I should just add on a bit for what DSoul said, because I think for local culture, right, like, I think not just in Singapore, but in Asia as well, most people, when they do something, they want to make sure that they bring out their best, or they want to, they don't want to show like a weak side of them, especially in Asia, you know, maybe that's the way our school system is. But let's not go into that. So based on that, right, I realized that in a cypher, everybody is scared to come out because they don't want to show something, a weak side of them, you know. So to me, that actually defeats the purpose of a cypher, because it becomes like an organized, a circular audition. You know, everybody is trying to see like, oh, you know, this guy is good, what can I do better, like, how am I going to not look bad and all that. But then it feels very, it defeats the purpose. Then everybody don't want to go out, you know what I mean? So it needs to become a conversation and become something social where you don't really care like whether what you're doing is at a certain level or what. You just go represent yourself, you know, and exchange, and then have a conversation, and then you never know where it might lead to or where it might go. But it's definitely going to be better than just not going out, you know? Because a competition and like a contest is not the most important thing, because this dance was built on around people and not around scores and around like numbers and trophies. Yeah.
It's not about the judgment.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So let me move on to my next question. So what are some of the unspoken rules and norms of the cypher? Maybe I can ask this question to Psyk. All right.
Hi. But I thought a lot. Unspoken rules of the cypher.
What's some of the etiquette?
Okay.
Dances in a circle.
Well. Okay. I'll just like go back in time a little bit, and then share with you my experiences, like to add on also at the same time to what Frantick and Marcus both said. Frantick, Marcus, Michael, all, you know, we all started out like all in a crew, and then we would eventually, being in a crew, you would end up in a sort of like a confrontation, something like that, like a challenge of sorts, but it's more like a cipher in a circle. So fast forward to the days when me and Michael used to train, and I was in a b-boy crew. I cannot b-boy, but I was in a b-boy crew. And then what would happen is, for all of us in the crew, it's always about improving ourselves, not because I want to get better for myself, but it's I want to get better for my crew. So when I go out there, I represent my crew, not just me. So it's like double the weight of my responsibility out there. So fast forward, somehow we used to go to clubs a lot, because Michael said we only have like this handful of people who would dance, and there's no like popping jams, they don't play funk, it's mainly breaks. But what we learn from there is that energy, that mentality of I'm gonna show you what I have and then you show me what you have, and that way you make friends. Okay, so funny story, once Michael was at Zoo and then he was dancing, then the bouncer stopped him and said, excuse me, can you dance normally like other people?
Yeah.
Zoo last time had a rule,
you can do
whatever you want, but the moment you touch the floor, the bouncer will bring you out.
He was popping
and then the bouncer down. Told him, please.
And then said, what are you doing? I said, I'm just dancing. He said, No, can you just do normal dance like everybody else? Don't do anything like that. Then I'm like, oh, okay. Then I went back and I did the same thing again. And then he dragged me out again. And he said, are you on drugs? Like, you don't understand what I'm talking about. Are you drunk? Then he wanted to kick me out. But that was very long ago.
Yeah, I remember. But
you were there.
No, you told me. What we used to do whenever we saw a dancer getting down was, and I'm pretty sure a lot of you do the same thing. You see someone getting down the circle, then you be like, and then you start to, hey, you see that guy, and then you're dancing, then you start to walk, and then eventually you somehow end up at the edge of the cypher. Right? And then when you have a chance, you go, it's like, I think that's a good attitude to have if you don't. But for me, the most important unspoken rule is, if you go into a cypher, right, it's not really about trying to kill someone off. It's not really about trying to destroy someone or everyone else in the circle around you. It's more like going in to represent who you are and making a statement saying, this is me, I am who I am, and this is the way I dance. No matter what, whatever level you are at, there's always something that you can put on the table. You can bring something to the table that is going to be different from everyone else there. The music is always going to be different. It's not a control environment where, okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, music change. The DJ changes the music according to the flow, so you have to follow the flow at the same time. The most important rule is to give your very best, to pay respect to the other dancers there as well. And when they are dancing, if you really want to make sure that this is a cypher, like 1 person by 1 person cypher, then watch that person when they dance. Then you can learn at the same time, because it would suck for you to go out there trying to show people this is how I dance and no one's looking at you. You know what I'm trying to say? But it goes two ways. What DSoul said, look at people when you dance, it's a connection. So that's your unspoken rule when you're dancing. You don't dance for yourself. If you want to go into a cypher, don't look at the floor. You went in. So connect to the people around you. Then when you come out and the next person comes in, connect with that person as well. So this is my answer.
Alright. Maybe I'll ask the same question to Greenteck at the very end. Like, what are some of the unspoken rules of the cypher?
Ain't got no rules for me. Everybody got his own way to see it, and for me, I ain't got no rules. That's where everything comes out. My emotions, everything, my struggle in life, it goes there. I leave it there, I feel better, I go home. Thank you for sharing the cypher with me, people around. That's how I feel. Understand?
Right.
Yeah.
Can I speak on that real quick?
Yes, of course.
So as you see, there's different versions of who we are. The goal is to be yourself, be true to who you are. Now, there's ways of earning respect in a circle. There's ways of respecting the circle. There's ways of just like, if I'll give an example. I went to a club in San Francisco. It's a house club called Mighty. Dope house music, always, every Friday. One of the best clubs in San Francisco. There's a b-boy by the name of A-Game, and he's from Style Elements Crew. And I remember going to this club and seeing him, and I could just feel like this guy was going through it, you know, and he was even apologizing. He was saying, like, telling people, like, yo, my bad, man. I just need to let it out. And he's a respectable guy, but at the same time, he was going through so much at that time. The way he was entering that circle was like, it was the last of his life, you know what I'm saying? So imagine that, you're going through so much in your life that you're using the cipher to release that energy, to release either that anger, that love, that passion for what you do. So yeah, there's also, you know, unspoken rules, like, don't step on my shoes, you know, we're gonna battle. Don't touch me, we might fight. There's things that you shouldn't do, and that comes with respect, you know? It's just respect the dancers, like, yo, apologize. You know, if you touch somebody, like, oh, my bad, but keep doing what you're doing, but at least acknowledge the fact that it didn't mean to disrespect, like, Greenteck, because he'll definitely go after you, you know, because he has no rules. So those people in the ciphers you gotta watch out for that will go like a lion after you. Yeah, so, but there were situations like when I was in high school, when I was a teenager, my principal, we had a new principal in our high school, and he straight up made a rule that we couldn't touch the ground with our hands while we danced. Our feet couldn't leave the floor as we danced. We cannot create circles as we dance. That was crazy. Because I was like, we're playing music during our lunch hour, where it's our time to have break, and it's our time to have food, and just be free from class for a moment, and you're telling us that we can't be who we are? So I created a petition, and I fought against that, because I was telling him straight up, like, yo, you have no idea what dance does for all of us. Like, do you want us to be vandalizing your school? Do you want us to be, you know what I'm saying? Because our public school system is really crazy in LA, so sometimes we can get pretty nuts. But I was trying to explain to him, like, the importance of allowing the culture to be what it is. You know, like, we're just dancing, bro. We're not here fighting. You know, just because you can't tell the difference doesn't mean that, you know, we're not doing something positive here. You know, and I always had to fight for that positivity. So, yeah, that's why I look at the things the way I do. But, word.
Also, unspoken rule for me is, well, it's a cipher, so you are exchanging, and there's a circle made, right? If you're not gonna exchange, you might as well stand in a single file line, you know? So the unspoken rule for me is like, yeah, exchange, so.
The idea of like getting into a circle and then make the circle work, and then if it's not like balanced out, like within the circle, there's no point forming a circle. Like, then I think that's what he's trying to say, right?
Yeah, there is a reason that there's a circle.
Drunk people ruin it.
Yeah, always clown the drunk people. Unspoken rule number two.
Always block them out.
Right. Okay. So at any point, if you have any questions or anything to add on, you can just like me, and I need a mic, and I'll give it to you.
Questions?
Yes, any questions about the cipher?
If you don't have questions, you're not really a student.
Boom. Boom. Run, Rachel, run.
How do you often cipher?
How often do you guys usually cipher? Like, how often do you get into a cipher?
It depends what city you're in. If you're in the woods, you ain't gonna cipher. But if you're in LA and It depends where you're in LA, but like if you're at a club with other dancers, you're gonna cypher for sure. So there's no like exact amount of time or how often.
I mean, it's like what we were discussing right now. It's like when you feel it, you know? When you feel you need to either exchange or learn or show, it's just based on your feeling. Guaranteed, I cipher at least, like, at the least once a week. It's guaranteed. Because in this lifestyle of dance and this culture, I'm either exchanging with b-boys, housers, trickers, or whatever. Like, all times to 10 different people. Yeah, I don't trick, but I love the fact that people can do flips and do crazy stuff to the music. If there's music being played, I'm definitely, even if it's a little baby, I'll be ciphering with a little baby. Boom. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just, it's all based on your preference and your feeling. But it's not a mandatory thing that you have to do. Don't look at it like that. Like, look at it as just something, it's that free, you know, the freedom to be able to exchange with the people around you. And eventually, hopefully, build a crew so that when you guys hit a cypher, you make an impact.
Right, any questions? Yes.
Hello, good afternoon. I have a question for Mr. Boogie Frantick. You were talking something about gaining respect in the cypher and respect for the circle. Yeah, can you elaborate more on it? Thank you.
Definitely. Okay, so just to give you like an example, you know, if I walk up to a circle, I'm either observing, but at least I'm keeping my distance from pushing myself forward. So I really don't want to take away from other dancers like being themselves, you know? But at that time, it's like I'm still appreciating what a circle is. So being able to watch and observe, and if there's a dancer that wants to come in, I'm not gonna like try to fight that person from going in the circle and being able to dance. I'm gonna let him do his thing, you know? The other thing would be like, if I accidentally touch somebody, you know, I'm gonna be like, oh, my bad, and then continue to dance. But at least acknowledge, or at the end of my set, like go over to the dude like, yo, my bad, I didn't mean to hit you like that, you know what I mean? If I stepped on somebody's shoes, I'm like, yo, apologize. But I won't, like sometimes if I'm so in the moment, I won't apologize until the end of my set, because it's just like, it just happens, you know? The music made me do it, so that's just kind of an unwritten rule. So that's another thing about respect, like you're respecting everybody. And at the same time, like, you're not acting a fool. You're not purposely calling everybody out and being that disrespectful towards everybody. Like, you're here to smoke everybody, you know? But there has been situations in my past where I eventually wanted to jump in a cypher and prove that I can battle every single person. Doesn't mean that I can beat every single person, but I can battle every single person. And that's a way of like earning my respect in that circle. You know what I'm saying? So those are different versions of respect. And I've gone through so many different ones where I've been around like great dancers of this culture and just have been able to share myself with OGs and been able to just definitely respect on that level where I'm not here to prove to them who I am. I'm just that energy that they're giving in this cypher, I need to have a piece of it. So I try to see if I can absorb some of that while they're dancing and keep the flow going. The other thing is, if I jump into like a house cypher, I'm not trying to change the vibe of the cypher. I'm not trying to let my ego overpower the fact that I'm a popper who loves to dance to house music. You know, what I'm doing is I'm still allowing the vibe to stay where it's at. If it's a house cypher, we're letting it be house. If it's a b-boy cypher, definitely letting it be b-boy. I'm not trying to go in there and change the perception of everybody. Like, hey, look at me, I'm a popper. Boom. You know what I'm saying? It's just, I'm still sharing the music, sharing the love for the sound. And that's really what it is. Like, once you love that music, you guys, it should be something you all can appreciate together.
Yeah.
Alright. Okay, I have a personal question. So, Frantic was mentioning about like calling people out in the ciphers. Because I think in Singapore, calling out is not, like calling people out is not that common. And I just wanna find out like, how does a cipher exchange turn into like a call-out battle within the cipher? Like how does it happen? How does it end? Does it change the vibe of the cipher when people call people out? Is it, if all of us hear cipher together and I call Marcus out, is it everybody don't dance and just watch us battle it out for rounds after rounds or what? Like how does it end? Should they go aside or what?
Well, that also comes into respect. Like, if you see two people battling, let them do their thing and appreciate that moment. Like, stand there and watch and support both of them so that it doesn't get too confrontational. That's another way to respect the cipher. Like, you're allowing these people to battle. But, yeah, like, you can... I'll give a... I was at KOD in Los Angeles, right? The finals. And while the people were dancing, I decided to start ciphering with my Canadian homies. So we started exchanging right then and there. Like I purposely was like, we're standing here, like I need to dance. I'm sorry. It's dope music, let's just get down. Boom, we started getting down. By the second, I would say the next round of battles, it turned into a heated situation where it was Poppintronic versus John Bugs. And they were really going at each other. Now, I'm looking at my boy Tronic, and he's, before he even started battling John Boogs, he was battling one of our young homies from LA. Now, here's one, I tried to give him a lesson at that time, and I was like, yo bro, like, why are you battling him? He's from LA. Like, exchange with somebody from somewhere else. We have people from Germany, we have people from Canada, we have people from France, Korea, China, like there's other people here that want to get down. Like, exchange with them, you know? But because there was a personal situation between John Boogs and Tronic, Poppintronic decided to cut off John Boogs' round. Then that caused a battle. So as John Boogs was coming out, Tronic came out and cut him off to purposely make a point. You have no respect here. So that caused confrontation. Then I had to stand there and make sure that everything was cool, because it did get to a point where they went outside and had a discussion. And you know, that's like, that's what I mean. Like, you can eventually exchange with somebody to the point where it's like, sometimes you're gonna feel like either maybe the person is trying to make you feel less of yourself or more. And that's where you can continue to keep your guard up. And you need to protect yourself at that point. You know, that's the respect for yourself. Like if I'm calling out Green, even though we're crew, we're family, and he starts to see, like I'm purposely trying to test him, he's gonna read that right off the bat and go, okay, then we're gonna be here for hours. Because we definitely can cipher all day. You know, and that's when it gets to that point where it's like, are you done? But are you done? Nah, I'm not done. And I'm gonna keep going, and he's gonna keep going. So we're gonna push each other to that limit, to the point where it's just like, you're sweating, you're tired, you're exhausted, and either it gets too personal where one of us loses control and we start arguing, or we keep that composure and eventually shake hands and was like, hell yeah, that was an exchange. Because we're exhausted, you know? I've had situations like that where I called out Jay Smooth and we went for like 45 minutes. You know, and we were both like gassed out, but I wasn't gonna quit. I was not gonna quit. I wasn't outside breathing heavily, that's for sure though.
Yeah, I think call outs are an interesting thing. It's like it goes one or two ways. It's like you call out of respect or you call out of disrespect. So it gets a little interesting when it is disrespect. You don't really know when the battle ends. It's kind of that unspoken rule. Like you look at the crowd and you're like, yeah, I just got smoked. yeah, I'm gonna stop dancing now. So like, you kind of have to have that feeling, like your homies are telling you like, hey bro, you lost this one. Just step back. You know? Or yeah, some people just don't want to accept the loss too, you know, like somebody like John Books will never lose. Yeah, that's the ego, you know. So yeah. It gets interesting, you know. Dance is not really about so much rules, you know. It's just kind of like you go with the feeling, and that's it.
He's called me out.
I have called him out. He gave me a tie, and I won the battle, but he was tripping. He didn't want to be. He didn't want to give me the win. He's always a big bro. He always being hard on me. So, yeah, you like for me when I battle. Like, Frantick, if he's the judge, he goes hard on me. Like, I really have to make it clear. Because he's not going to be one of those judges where he's like, hey, that's fam right there. Yeah, I'm going to take care of him. He won, you know? He goes extra hard. I thought I clearly won that battle, but we might have to go
which,
rounds later still. I'm
which
still
battle
there.
Was that? When was that? Which battle was that?
That battle was a long time ago. It was maybe like 3 or 4 years ago. I'm still hurt. I'm kidding. He smoked me, though.
If he does so, he does good.
See, I gotta do it.
We can't wait to see you guys.
Yeah.
Call each other out later. Just saying.
Let's go. Out of respect, though.
When I was at an event, back in New York, I saw Greenteck in the circle and everyone's like calling him out and like, and they're not like really calling him out, it's just like going towards him and he's just like going with this guy and exchanging with the other guy, he's just like going rounds after rounds. But then I just want to also find out like, how does it end? How does like the exchange end? Like if people like go up to you and like, you, get up. How like,
How does it end? Every time is different. Okay, it depends on the situation. Sometimes it doesn't end nice. It's true. But you have to grow from that. And as a person, you learn something in life. But sometimes it doesn't good when everybody is on the same kind of level. And you learn from it too. Like, I made a best friend in circle. And enemies. So it's like that, it's like life, you know. Sometimes you talk to someone, you kind of feel the same vibe, and sometimes it's not going down at all. Yeah, so I don't know how to say exactly the perfect way it ends, but you go with the flow and always try to live peacefully. It's hip hop, you know. There you go.
All right, good advice right there. God. Okay, maybe I'm just gonna move on to something more about building your own style, like what pop progress is also about, like about how you progress as a dancer and how do you build your own style. Okay, so let me pose this question to Nick. Okay, so let's talk about what's the importance of like finding your own style, and then like how do you do that other than just creating like variations or moves? Like what other than creating variations and moves, how do you create your own style in the dance?
Okay, I think okay, hi guys. Nervous. Okay. Before I talk about like finding your own style, I think I wanted to say about how we can stay focused, you know, because if you want to find your own style, first of all, you have to be focused with what you want. Then you can find something you want, you know. So it goes back to like, maybe in terms of like Singapore people, it's just my opinion, you know, like Singapore people, like we are very, like everything also want, greedy. Yeah, so in terms of even genres of dance, we like, we have no time already and we still like, oh, I want this, everything, the kiasu, you know, so it goes back to sorting out and having your focus, your direction and your discipline. Then you can find out what you want. Let alone going deeper into finding your style, finding a particular like waving, just popping style, animation, you know. So all in all, I feel to find your style, you need to sort out what you really want and not trying to be greedy and having everything, wanting everything. But I mean, it's good to have everything, to want to learn everything, but take your time, step by step, phase by phase. Go through every single phase to grow. It's not a 1 month journey, but it's like a years of journey and lifelong learning. So for me, this is how I grow. You know, people see me as like, I don't know, maybe I always hear like waving animation, but in fact I like rolls a lot. Yeah, and I like tarts, but I cannot tart. Yeah, so for me, it's like phase by phase, years after years, I try and move on to different stuff. Yeah.
Right. And also, I'll ask Marcus the question. Like, how do you build your style and how do you think your style has changed over the years and why does it change?
I think for me, like, I want to say something from Nick's comment about finding what you like, right? So for me, I also feel that a big part of creating a style is listening to yourself and like knowing what you like and not just what people like, and then you just follow what people like. You know, like example, if there's a new cronut store that opens in Singapore, right? Then everybody's like, oh shit, I like cronut, I love cronut, but you haven't even tried it before, you know? But like, you know, people start to influence you and then you don't really know whether you like it or not, and then you just jump into it. So I think the biggest thing about finding your style first is like understanding yourself and what you really like. And I think it's worth it to spend time like not just dancing but like in life understanding yourself more and like what you like, you know, like who are you? You know, are you like smooth kind of like feeling? Are you very chill or are you very like, you know, uptight or what? You know, understanding this, right, actually contributes to your style because you then find a style that fits your character the most. Okay, and it's not easy, and for a lot of us, it's a lot of trial and error, but as long as you know what you like, you're slowly getting there day by day. So, and I think that also applies to the cipher, like a call out, the same thing. When we express what we are, honestly and sincerely, right, it's real. You know, like I've seen a lot of like fake call outs in Asia, you know, like they call out and then they're all smiling and they're laughing, and it's like, might as well not call it a call out, you know, just dance. But you know, you want to do everything real, like in the cipher, when you get in there, right, you want to exchange, you want to share, you want to contribute and all, make sure that you have that vibe. You don't just go in and, okay, I'm going to go one round, I'm going to stand one side and that's it, I'm done. You know, then don't do that, you know what I mean? Like, try to feel the right, like, emotion and the sincerity, and that's the most important thing. Because when you're sincere yourself, you believe in what you do better, and when you believe in what you do better, you can train that and you push it to a high level. So for me, to cut the long story short, right, I learned like what everybody did. Like we went through like martial arts, you know, we go through like a school and we learn, everybody learns the same punch, the same kick, the same thing, okay? And after that, then I start to realize, oh, you know, I like certain things, I like this feeling more and all that. Then I start to realize, yeah, I want to try this, I want to try that. But it's also important to work hard when you want to try something, you know? So I feel that the foundation, like going through what others went through, didn't really like crazily create my style, but it helped me to get some discipline, you know, to get some motivation to get things done. So I would say, like, no matter what path you take, right, as long as you work hard, that's important, okay? But then if you really want to go far, you gotta believe in yourself more. Okay, so I'm a strong believer of like learning in every situation, whether it's in a bad situation or a good situation. So I would say like, for me, I take every step along the way as a learning point. So even if it made me go one round to find out what I like, I felt it was worth it every step. And you know, for Singaporeans, you all are very short of time, you know, you got studies, work and everything. So I would say like, my advice to you guys is really
take some time off, like, and think about it more than just doing it, you know, just rushing into things is not going to get you anywhere. It will get you stronger, like, and you know, some physical experience, but you know, if you, like what I said, like, if you go far, trust yourself more.
I'm just going to quickly add on, this is how I explain style. I think basically everybody loves to dance. I mean, if you watch even a young, small baby, you know, kid, a toddler would listen to music and he would just move. And the parents are, I never teach her or him anything. He's just moving by him or herself. So personally, I think that we do have a way that we like to move, okay? Even if it's off the count of the beat, but it's still the way that you like to move. Okay, you like to use your head more, you like to use your arms more, you like to use your elbows more, you like to go on the floor, you like to use your hips more. So basically, I think you just need to know what you really like to do, okay? And just train it, train the shit out of it, okay? And I think it's basically almost like a Venn diagram. So basically, this is what your style is. And if you want to do a style like popping, basically, I think you could just strip away flavors of it and just keep the bare techniques and essentials. And you could also find out what you like from all these techniques, like among all these styles of popping, what is it that you like? And if you train hard enough, you could find an intersection. The intersection where the things that you like, you know, it's very close to what you've been training for. And you would showcase that intersection in a battle. So this is how this is would be your popping, okay? And if you want to, you could remove the whole popping and just do your own style. And by right, if you can remove all your style and just show only popping as it is. That's what I feel. And if you know your style well, the next time you learn another style, whacking, and you find out what's the technique, what's really important, and then you try to find again the intersection. And then you would showcase that as working and everything else. But this is my interpretation.
Oh, can I just add one thing real quick? With regards to Michael about styles, right? For me, right, I believe that a style or a name, a category or a label, right, is such a small word to define something so big. So the dance is can never be like defined by something that is just a word, you know. So like, example, you see this floor here, right? So let's say like this is popping and like here is like breaking or something, okay, outside. So you could be really into popping, okay, like here, but I could be someone whose style is almost here, you know, but I'm still considered in this genre, but it's not true, okay? So like,
maybe you could be anywhere in this style. Okay. Okay. So yeah, you could be anywhere within the style, but it's not the same. Standing here and standing there, we are in this label, but we are so different. Okay, so it's not enough to just say like, you know, I'm a popper and I only can do this. So you got to start to understand, like, labels are just ways for people to like understand a certain concept easier. But it does not define the concept itself, you know. So for me, that's why I always like to understand more style, so that when I stand here, like I know, like, oh, you know, this is popping, and popping is like that, and b-boy is like that, and I'm standing here, so I sort of like understand both sides a bit better than just I'm still a popper, you know what I mean? Yeah.
So I hope that will help you like understand styles and you know.
So, can we clarify the question again real quick?
How do you find your own style and how do you do that?
Yeah.
Other than
variation. Yeah. So I really love this question, so I could talk forever about this, but I creativity is one. It's really like, first off, I grew up in LA, so it's like, as far as popping goes, it's the land of monsters. So finding your own style is very hard to do because when you talk about liking stuff, you got so much to like in LA. Like, you have the top dogs, right? You got OGs that nobody's heard about, and they're doing crazy stuff in cyphers. So for me, it was hard to try and battle with that, you know, especially having similar elements as other poppers, whether it be tutting, waving, robot. A lot of people do those styles. So how do you make it different? So you kind of have to ask yourself, what is creativity? Some people define creativity as taking things that have already been done and just melding them or intertwining them together in a different way. So whether it's like I take tutting and I do a tut twisto wave, boom, like that's something new, right? And for me, it's like when I think about creativity as well, it's also how you perceive other dancers. When you watch their dance, do you just see the physical movement, or do you see feeling? Do you see like colors? Do you see shapes? What do you see when you watch other dances? I try not to see the movement, I try to see the person, you know? So by that, I'm influenced by things that aren't physical, they're metaphysical. They're things, they're emotions, they're ideas, their thoughts, feelings, you know? So for me, it's like, as a dancer, it's about taking your life experience, which is makes you all unique. Every perspective in here is slightly different. For someone, public speaking might be very difficult. Another person, it's like their shit, you know? So you have a diverse experience, but how do you put that into physical movement, right? That's the hardest part. How do you take sadness and put it into waving? Or how do you take anger and put it into tutting, right? That's how I think about it, is taking your personal experience and infusing it into your dance. Does your dance reflect your life? Yeah.
Yeah. I will add on to this question about finding your style, because I personally think that my style has changed the most number of times over the years that I've started popping. I'll start off with giving you a metaphor. All of you are individuals. We all like this dance, but we look at it from, let's say, for example, perspective of fashion. Okay, each one of you has a certain fashion preference, but there's like different styles, right? Street style, preppy, or whatever. We always have labels for that. But within those styles, you have other things like brands, colors, fit, cut. You know, and you choose something that suits you, right? Or you buy something. Like when you see someone else wearing something, you think that's cool, you want to find out where they got it from, you went there and you try it on, if you realize it doesn't fit your body, or it doesn't look good, you don't get it, correct? I mean, you don't just, unless you're a hype boy and then you want to just, you know, whatever's hype, you just buy it, like Marcus Norris joking. He too hype baby. Anyway, so you think about it this way, okay? Next metaphor I like to use is food, like cooking food, you know? In order for you to start to really cook, I'll use a simple dish, fried rice. What's fried rice to everyone? But fried rice has like 10,000 variations of fried rice. But in order for you to cook nice fried rice according to your own standard, for yourself to eat at least, you have to understand how to make fried rice in the first place. That's the base foundation. Same for this dance. When I first started out, I didn't even know that this style of dance is known as popping. All I wanted to do was be a robot. I really wanted to be a robot. I grew up watching Transformers, and I told myself, I want to be a robot. And I drew inspiration from right outside of my house. There was a construction site, and I was looking at all these construction vehicles and stuff, and they were moving with hydraulics and stuff. I just got my inspiration from that. And I just started being a robot. I wasn't on music or anything. But I basically went so far into this zone where I really wanted to be a robot till my mom started coming, hey, robot, yeah, let's go. You know, so that already says something to me. But after a while, I saw people doing waves. Then I was like, oh, that's cool. It's not that someone told me, hey, waving is cool. I saw it and I said to myself, I like that, that's cool, what's that? So it's a wave. And then I saw it being done by some K-pop artist back in 2000. H.O.T. So I'm old school K-pop. But when I saw them doing wave, I was like, I don't even understand how this is done. I tried a little bit and I basically was a bit thick-skinned. I put a video of myself on bboy.org or breakdance.com. It's a really, really old website. And I got dissed by someone on the forum and the person said, bro, your waves suck. So I took it pretty personally because I thought I was a shit. Like I didn't see anyone else in my area or my school doing this. I thought I was a shit. But I got dissed by this guy. So what did I do? I just recluse and I locked myself in my room and I trained waves for like 3 months. Just nothing but waves. I stopped the robot, I stopped everything, just waves. But during this period of time about researching more about waves, I found a lot more about the Liquid community. And at that point of time, I don't think anyone really cared about Liquid in Singapore. But there was this whole community that whatever they were doing looked like waves. And they had an extension of it which was digits, and that's like with your fingers. I was like, oh shit, that's like something new to me. So it's like, because no one was telling me anything, I wanted to get this done, I wanted to prove a point. I like waves, I went into research for all these things. Yes, my understanding, I dare to say my understanding of this particular style improved a lot. And then when I went back to that forum thing, I was like, okay, I'm gonna try this out, I'm gonna post another clip. Then the same guy that said shit about me totally forgot who I was by then. And he was like, oh my god, this guy, your waves are dope. I'm like, oh, okay, cool. I made a point now. Okay, but this carried on for a few years till I met Michael. And then his style of dance was different. It's still popping, but everyone was like, hey, you know, right? You're very robot. Then this guy, every time he's jerk very big, jerk. I was like, what's this? So basically, he influenced me to go find out what the hell is hitting about. You see, and then fast forward a few years, when I saw Melvin dance, I was like, wow, what's this? So he was doing a lot of glides, a lot of rolls, and I was interested in learning it. So I learned that. And then that changed me. As I took lessons overseas after that, like, from Aki, especially Aki changed my mind. Aki changed my mind, Frankie changed my mind. And I could not understand the meaning of being free, let loose and just like stop being a robot and standing on the spot and move around and stuff. So I was like, yeah, that's really cool. I want to learn. So I went to seek that and I trained it as much as I could. Fast forward many years, Mr. Wiggles came into my life, not really, but I met Mr. Wiggles and then I see, and yeah, he's always been an inspiration, but when he did the whole 52 handstyles thing, it immediately resonated with me because I felt a connection to it from my history, from where I started, which was like in a b-boy crew, and I also learned martial arts when I was a kid. He's doing Wing Chun now, by the way, but anyway, I learned martial arts as a kid. So it really resonated with me. I wanted to learn. So what did I do? I went directly to him and I said, hey, please, explain this to me, teach it to me, I want to learn. So he showed me this is the foundation of where he got it from. And then he shared some with me and I went to train. So the question back to you is, how do you find your own style, right? It's not about people telling you what's in or not about you watching a person. Like nowadays, a lot of us get too caught up in the famous dancers and you just want to be another copy of it. Or video copiosis, we call it, right? Video copiosis. That's a syndrome where you watch too many videos and then when you finally hear the same song, the image of the dancers in your head, you dance like that guy. You hit the same beats, you do the same moves, or you get to the same angles as that person. Now, the reason why these people here are who they are is because they understand not just the sub-style of the dance. Like for example, puppet. How many of you here have really spent time to go train the puppet? Understanding. Understanding is the key. Number two is understanding your own body. Like for example, Greenteck can go so low to the ground. How many of you was inspired by that? You all were, right? But did you put the same amount of hours and time that he spent training that? You did not. That's the reason why he can freak so many things in that position, because that is what he put in there. He understands his body, he understands that angle. Why is Frantick so good at all these waves? Because he understands it, he went all the way in. Same for Michael, Marcus, Rachel, Nick. You know, if it's like when I was at a session and I watched Marcus and Rachel dancing, now I realized all they did was just, they would say, hey, we just try some toy man angle. They were like this. So immediately in my mind, okay, well, toy man is just like this. Then I realized that what they were doing is different, completely different from what I expected. They didn't just have the head angles, they had body angles as well. They had different levels, they had different positions. And I was like, wait, it's just one angle like this. But because of the way they were exchanging, in a funny angle like that, it totally changed the entire thing. It made me realize, oh my god, that's how little of myself I understand. So the question back to you is, how do you find your style? You gotta understand yourself, number one, what you are capable of. Like me, I have a problem with my knee. So I cannot squat down an Asian squat, and I have to squat this way because I have surgery done here. So that's why a lot of you realize men don't really go down. I can't. But because of this, right, I need to find a way to counter that. And I'm comfortable doing this all the time, so why can't I dance at this angle? You know what I mean? Instead of saying, I cannot go down, so I won't do it. You know? And then you have to understand your sub style too. What is the sub style that you like? Not because someone told you. There's so many for you to choose. Puppet, scarecrow, toy man, you know, waving, cutting, all this. It's really what you like. Then imagine this all the way back again to what I talk about, fried rice. What's the ingredient you like to taste in your fried rice, in your fried rice for yourself, right? So that is my answer to how to find your own style.
Alright, I guess just to wrap it up, like I think last year when the future came and he got a workshop, he also taught us how to kind of like analyze and dissect how you actually watch videos, because everyone was very obsessed about watching videos, especially battles. So everyone found their favorite like flavor of the month, like on videos itself. Like, I really like this person. But then when you ask that person, why do you really like this dancer? They can't really break it down for you. And then when they can't break it down, they will just want to have it wholesale. Like, I just want to look like him, I want to dress like him, I want to smile like him when he dances and wear the cap like that also. You know, so you get lost in situations like that, and I feel that the moment you try to think a bit deeper and break down your thoughts about what you really like, although it is a very difficult question about what you really like, I guess that's really how you find your way to yourself. Because like for me, I really have a lot of dancers that I admire, like all of you. But there are really some that I watch and then I feel like, oh my god, I want to cry. And then most of these times I don't see, like, they are not from battle videos. I don't know if that's the same for everyone. Yeah, so, and also one thing I think is also for ladies who are doing the style, it might be difficult like to always be watching different men like rocking the style, and how do we find our own style in this particular dance that we do? And I feel that it's really just go out there and then just represent yourself. If you're feminine, and then so be it, like, look at the shit, like what all these other men says.
Okay, something like that to add on is liking what you, loving what you want to do, and something that you are good at, and versus something that is going with the flow. Going with the flow meaning like if people do, you do, and kind of just following, copying, and then like just doing the same thing. So for me, like back then I started from Michael. He taught me how to pop and lock. So, but you don't see me locking really. Rather, I didn't really lock for a very long time. So back then I was like, I tried both, you know, pop and lock. But I couldn't really pop very well, because popping is difficult. But locking itself, I could like pick up the movements easily, like more easily, you know. So, but to me, it's like, what I really wanted to do back then was popping. Like, it was his Google video that inspired me to, oh, I want to do that the wave, that glide, that those things. Yeah. So this is about loving what you want to do and attempting and pushing for it, making it happen, versus doing something that you are comfortable with, you are good at, and just going with flow. Okay? And going with the flow, also for me personally, like before I started dancing, I was in poly. So before that, I wasn't a dancer, I was a gamer. Then after that, my classmates just sort of like put me to this CCA, asked me to go for the auditions, which is foreign bodies. I'm sure I see some of them. Yeah, so I failed the audition, obviously. It was a hip hop club, you know. So I failed the audition, and from there, then I saw Michael's video and I picked up popping. But there was one day, Chunky, Ian, our locking OG. So he was telling me, hey Nick, this is a blessing in disguise. Like, if actually I passed the auditions, I would be following the flow and like, I may be doing hip-hop now. Yeah, so put these three into considerations in your life and in the, this journey that you will choose and take. Even to say to your juniors too, like, I believe I see many club members here, like SF and US people, yeah. So, share this with your juniors, like, doing what they love to do and focusing on it is more important than going to flow and just, or doing things that you happen to pick up faster, you know? Yeah, so that's just my 3 cents. Thank you.
3 cents, not 2 cents, one more cent, Okay, I like this next question. Okay, I think this is also another topic that is not so common in Singapore, but it's a really huge thing, like, in the popping culture and the community. It's about the dance as a performance and having a storytelling element. Because in the States, like, there's still a lot of pioneers doing the dance on the streets, like street performers, whether is it busking, and it is not that common in Singapore. And I want to find out, like, from Frantick, like, how do we improve as performers, as storytellers, and what are the elements, like, for this dance?
Be free. Storytelling and popping is for me, it's a huge impact on your presentation. Like, when you give somebody a birthday gift, you don't just be like, hey, I bought this for you, you know? It's kind of crazy. I mean, even though you could be really good close friends and do that, like, yo, I got you something, bro. Like,
I did that
shit to me. Yeah, no, I did actually. But,
I left a mattress in my living room for a birthday present.
Oh yeah, what is that? What is mattress? Give him a mattress for, I give him a bed to sleep on. Why? Because he was sleeping on like a mat. So you know what? If you don't appreciate it, get out.
I am mad.
What do you got right there? no, but it's huge for me because like I've performed in some of the craziest situations. I performed in some of the craziest situations. Like I'm gonna share this with all of you now. I performed in front of my family, standing in front of my brother's dead body and his services, you know? I performed for a friend of mine who asked me to do the same thing for his family. This was like last year. I performed in front of his father's casket to his father's favorite song, you know? So, and I've done it in front of kids. I've done it in front of grown-ups. I've done it in front of movie stars. I've done it in front of like TED Talks, you know? Like there's so many ways of performing. But the thing was, the reason I was able to provide this service was because of my presentation. The fact that I don't just boogie on down, you know? I actually present something right before I'm about to actually go like super deep into the music. And I realize when I look at like an orchestra, you know, everybody waits for the conductor. And to me, that's like a huge story. When you see this is my orchestra here, and you see the conductor come, and he takes his sweet time. You're gonna notice this in orchestras. He takes his sweet time, because he wrote the music. This is the mastermind right here. Looks at everybody he's been scolding, yelling at, giving the hardest time to, looking at him going, you better not mess this up. We work so hard for this. I'm gonna lift this stick and you're gonna perform your hearts out. You know what I'm saying? So imagine having that power in front of all of you. The fact that all I have to do is raise this hand to the sound and grasp your attention.
That's crazy, right? Presentation. I could easily walk from here to over there with my hand in my pocket and give you that story that I'm easily gonna pull something out, throw it in the air, believe it's really there, grab it, and change the whole concept of this idea. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's all about presentation. Like, simple things is how you would present something. Not just, it has to do with everything. The way you dress, the way you present yourself. You really wanna give your 100 in what you're doing, you know, so that when you're out there, you're pushing the boundary of your own creativity. Like, you've trained enough, you've danced enough to this moment where all eyes are on you. We're now stepping into your world. And you can care less about what anybody else thinks, because at that moment, it's all about you and where you're at and where your creativity goes, you know? So, it's interesting, you know, like being able to do that to me is super important. And I learned it from so many different like dancers and dance styles, the way they present themselves, the way they enter the music. I've seen people like pray to the ground, bless the ground. I've seen people bless the sky. I've seen people bless everybody else before they even perform, you know. Yeah, it's interesting. Like, it's really a huge impact to really present your style. Because even jumping in a cypher, like, he has creative ways of doing so, because he jumps in the cyphers with b-boys. And b-boys have no chill. There's no chill. Like, you have to fight your way into that circle so that you have that moment to shine. And for, like, you can have the most creative way to jump into a cypher. But as soon as you're in the middle and you stand up, it's your time. So you can give that moment. Or you can be that style of dancer where you, as soon as you jump in, you're just going in. And you're not letting anybody stop you until you're done. Who's seen that? Where you've seen like two dancers, boom, they bump into each other in the middle of the circle and they both start dancing right away. You know, like when you see that, you're like, oh, but then the next person comes in and kills it. It's like your all eyes are on that person. So it's timing, you know, it's all about that presentation. Like being able to really grasp that attention from everybody. Performing is a huge key. Like music. We all love music, right? Right? Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Just trying to make sure you guys are awake here. I'm falling asleep too. I'm just kidding. But yeah, like we all love music, so how long does it take to make a song, you know? Like, you gotta give the respect to the person who created that beat as well. And by doing that, it's literally dissecting a song and then getting to that point where you just know this track. So if you're performing, if you're creating a performance, you're not just gonna go off and be like, hey, can you just play whatever? And just do your thing, unless that's what you're good at. If that's what you're good at, then that's simply your presentation. Like, yo, man, play that beat real quick. Right then and there, that's your presentation. That's your setup. Unless you really create that show, that performance that tells a story. It could be about your life. It could be, you know, you really have to push that boundaries. I've done a performance with a friend of mine where we were talking about child abuse, because I was abused as a kid as well. And we did this whole performance based on being abused. That was like a whole different creativity, that creative level. And I was like, you know what, I'm gonna act like I'm getting punched in the face and kicked in the stomach. And it was like a whole contemporary way of dancing using popping, you know? That was different. But yeah, I mean, storytelling is huge. Don't be afraid to change. Yeah, Charlie Chaplin. Look at the silent films. Look at all the silent films. Imagine that. We're back in the 20s, people were sitting there watching a movie and it was this quiet. And then when it was a funny moment, everybody would be laughing. But yeah, it's crazy, right? Be that conductor. I believe in you.
Wow.
my god, weehee! So if there's none to add on, I want to throw the question. I mean, I'm gonna open up to the floor for any questions. We have like only 10 minutes left for the conference. If you have any questions for any of our guests about culture in their country, community, how is it like?
What's the shoes I wear?
I got a question.
Do I like to cook?
What's up, Josh?
Okay. Do you know of any communities that maybe some time ago it wasn't the Cypher culture wasn't strong, and then after a few years when you went back, it became strong. It became really good and everyone's sharing. And my question then is, how did they do that? Yeah.
Honestly, everywhere I've traveled, I've saw a circle or two. So I can't really say like one place was weak and then eventually became stronger. I do know that when it comes to new dance styles, like turfing for instance, like it's a San Francisco dance style, it's an underground dance style that's created by these kids on the streets. It didn't have any ciphers, you know, it didn't have exchanges. But they started to use certain events to bring in their dance and to help it form by joining ciphers with other styles. So I've seen dancers grow into where they kind of have like dope exchanges, you know? Even like Crump from LA, like I've seen it grow worldwide from these kids in LA to like changing the world with Crump, literally, you know? So as far as like any place, no, I've always seen people exchange, but I've seen dance styles grow from creating ciphers and become stronger by it. Anybody else have something to say?
I think, with what Frantick said, like I'm a YG. I'm not like I haven't been around that long, you know. But I have traveled and I've been a lot of places, and I think Asia is in a unique position that really hasn't been encountered before. The dance culture and dance in general is a reflection of the culture. So Asia has a culture that is very, very respectful, but also like very inside the box, very following the rules is very important, you know? So I think, the cipher is, I think, inhibited in Asia by the same criticalness and judgment that Asia has. That makes them great and very unique. Like makes them great at math, right? Makes them, that's the stereotype. It makes them great at certain things, but it also inhibits creativity. And I think Cypher is learning to just turn off the judgment, like turn off the critical aspect, you know? Because the critical aspect is what makes you great, but you also have to have that switch, like, hey, just express right now, you know? So, sorry for the stereotype comment. That was kind of fucked up. My bad. It was just an example.
But yeah, like what he was talking about as far as the culture, because I noticed like a lot of the elders, you know, they're kind of held at a high respect. So what I have noticed is that a lot of the older poppers will cipher with each other, and the younger ones just kind of like are shy. And don't want, yeah, they're kind of standoffish. So, you know, eventually, hopefully that will grow into the point where even the elders will respect the younger cats to go ahead and dance and do that. So,
So this will be my question for you guys. What was the, or were the first few cyphers you guys were in? Can you remember? And how did it impact your dancing life? How did it all started? Could you try to like, you know, tell everybody the feeling there?
Like giving answer, this is all the show
Yeah. It was like your first cypher, and how did it
first impact?
My first real cypher for real was in LA. I went there, I was maybe 16, 17, 18, around this area. You know, skipping numbers. But yeah, I went to LA in the backyard boogie at the dojo, and I felt like I was in a movie, like breaking, you know. And from that, when you get that feeling where you can dance with somebody who's as old as your parents, you know, just getting down with you, and you don't feel so crazy. I felt like I was at home, and from that, I just went off, literally. Thank you, bro. Thank you. He's not talking about me though, I'm not as old as his parents. He's talking about my big brother, Jekyll, yeah, my big brother Hazy Jekyll, so.
It's actually interesting because the man that's sitting between us is like, that's like the first real cypher that I had too. You know, as I said earlier, I was like, I'm still shy. I'm introverted as I'm public speaking. But it was that freestyle session. And I hadn't been popping that long yet. And I'm standing around the circle, and I got like Boardman, Scorpio, Andre, and I'm just standing there like, oh, this is like legendary, you know? And Frantick is going in too, and all the OGs are like, damn. And he was on point. So like I'm standing there like this, I'm not even thinking about it, you know? And then Frantick comes over here and he makes a hole for me, like he waves out and he looks at me, right? And I'm like, nah, like, and then, but I had no choice, you know? I saw the box that he created for me and I was just like, I'm going in, boom. And like, I waved through the box and I was in the circle and like, it, the music just took over from there, you know? But then I came out and I was like shaking. I was like, God damn, that was scary. I don't know why. Well, when you dance in front of OGs, you feel like judgment, you know? Because that's just what it is, you know? That you respect the OG because they helped keep the dance alive. But at the same time, you can't be scared to drift from their authority, you know? Because they're always going to have a really strong opinion, but, you know, you also got to add, because they added too. Nobody was judging them before because there was nobody before. So we're in a unique place as everybody as dancers here. We're like, we're the next gen. So it's like, we got to carry that on and add on too, so.
Right. I think I'm just going to wrap up. Okay, after
Frantick. I'll make it really short, but it's actually pretty funny. My first cypher as a popper, I was in junior high school, and I saw a little circle going on, so I was excited. It was an after-school dance. I'm like, yeah, we got dances here, we got music, it's going down. You know, I've been training popping for like 3 years, no teacher, just kind of doing my own thing. This is even before I met like a lot of the pioneers. It was just around me. And I jump into the cypher and somehow end up in a battle against a person who was like 2 grades above me. So he's an older guy, you know? And we started going rounds and I'm doing like all these crazy miming tricks and waving and trying to add robots and hitting W's. And this guy literally was like in his last round, looks around and he's like, oh man, this guy keeps going. Jumps in, does this weird little robotic move, throws his hand up and rolls the middle finger up. Rolls it back down, and the crowd goes wild. I'm like, I did this whole rope thing and this whole, like, and everybody's kind of like zoned out, you know, watching me. And they're like tripping out because my miming wasn't that bad. But they go crazy over this. I was like, never again. Never again am I gonna get roasted by somebody's middle finger. Like, that is crazy. So that was my first like experience as a cypher. As a dancer, I was like 6 years old, and my sister made me battle two of her crewmates from her dance squad. My sister's like 5 years older than me, so she's now in junior high school, and they have a little crew. And I battled these two twins, and they smoked me so bad. Two against one. I remember I was even repeating moves because I just didn't want to stop dancing. But those are two definite cyphers that have impacted me for the rest of my life, because those were like, that was that moment to just, like, let me let it out, you know what I mean? Like, I just want to dance, and it's not about being accepted, it's like, just let me be me, you know? But yeah, those were the cyphers.
Right. Okay, I'm just gonna wrap up this conference by just posing one last question to the floor. Is, what if today Pop in Progress Grand Finals, we renamed it as Pop in Progress Cypher Party, will you come? I'm very sure like the attendance will not be the same as if it's a competition and if it's like a party. Because I think in Singapore, we are really lacking of party and cypher culture, because people see the importance of competition and contests, but they do not see the real importance of cyphers getting down and exchange. So I feel that our focus this year for 2016 is really bringing back the cypher culture. So we did like a hybrid of a contest and the cypher element to open up like the cypher mindset and bring it into an event where we know the contest element will still bring the crowd in at the same time. And yeah, at the same time, pushing this mentality across to the audience coming in as well. So like what Frantic mentioned just now about how like having new dancers and old dancers getting down all together, like what we're gonna do in a bit during our audition. It's also about merging both generations together, and then how the old generation can lead the new dancers by example, and also new dancers gonna just come in and like kind of like just show what you have also to the community to contribute your part for the scene as well. So I feel this entire cypher exchange culture is really something very, very important that we need to push up in our scene. Whether you do popping, whatever dance you do, cypher is really a big thing to go for the years to come. And this is just the first year that we're gonna push this. Yes. So thank you for that applause. Thank you. So can I just give a round of applause for all our panel guests? Greenteck, Frantick, DSoul, Marzipan, Michael, Nick, and Ben.